Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for coming to this Inspire implementation session. We are experiencing a few little hiccups this morning. One is of the technical kind, and then we're missing our moderator. So he may still come or not, but for the time being, I've been asked to kind of help in a bit. But I think we do this in a rather grassroots way, and people introduce themselves as they go. We have six presentations this morning until the coffee break, which is in the exhibition hall, just to inform you already about that. I'll start from the back. No, I don't introduce the presentations now. I'll just get started with my presentation first to make up some of the time. And okay, the topic of the session is Inspire Progress and Implementation. I would like to share with you a set of reflections of a mixed nature, which we are experiencing during the implementation we are supporting in the environmental domain. And I'm aware that's a bit risky to use the term obstacles, but I'll still go ahead and try to filter out a few items we have come across, which accompany us in this truly challenging, interesting, encouraging experience. I would like to trigger a few discussions here with the presentation. One is to take a look at the midterm review, which we have been doing. You are all aware, Inspire started in its legal form around 2007. It's meant to be in place by 2021. That's quite a time frame. Then there is a set of environmental challenges which accompany us. We have a discussion about the governance. We have a discussion around technical challenges. And then let's see what we learn from the present implementations. One slide I have, which was already shown in last year's Inspire conference, it's a summary, very short, on one slide of these midterm findings from that joint report we did together with the Joint Research Center late last year. And here are some points, and I would like later on to concentrate on the three on the bottom. But we can see that there is some delay in the implementation, some heterogeneity also in the implementation. There has been a survey where people have been identifying that most of the objectives, though, are still very valid, so we are basically still working on the right subject. And also the expected costs and benefits are roughly what they should be. Still, major investment and benefits still have to materialize. I mean, somehow it feels we have just started, especially for the environmental matters. And we are aware that parts of the implementation has been taken part in a time when Europe didn't have all the resources as it would have needed to ideally move quickly as one could eventually. So what there was identified already was there is more needed to embed Inspire into environmental legislation. And I have some reflection on that. We would need to improve coordination. It says here between neighboring countries, but I think very well also within countries. And somehow technical complexity and communication were identified as main areas of concern. First story around the environmental challenges. I just show two slides here, which kind of give you beyond, you all aware probably what people have been doing with the data specifications, trying to shape and to describe a certain variety which exists in the environmental domain. And this, it's called here the basic. Basically, the data specifications are based on that. But we are getting more challenges from the new analytical settings, because once we have the basis, we have to make use of it in some way. So we are confronted with these topics so that we can, with Inspire, we can support, for example, analytical work around the green economy or a circular economy, I mean, topics which we're discussing these days, around human health. Those are topics, are they properly supported by the basics which we are building with Inspire? This is a question. There's also a timeline in this. This timeline here shows, this is from the environmental action programs of the future. It shows a bit the sustainability agenda over time. and what the topics are. So these type of issues need to be supported also by the data work which we are doing around Inspire. And that provides us with a certain thematic challenge. I think we haven't fully the grip on it yet. To summarize, what we see here is that some countries are, of course, building their spatial data infrastructures, often based on e-government initiatives. There's also a certain good and powerful open data agenda, which drives data access. But on the data interoperability for the environmental side, I think we still have to go further. As I tried to show in the previous slides, environmental data is characterized by a broad set of themes which are dynamically evolving. So from that, we still have to derive more use cases, not only use cases based on the e-reporting. Inspire acts as a generic foundation, but we are suffering from the fact that Annex 1, for example, which should provide that foundation, is often not yet in place. By many stakeholders from the environmental area, Inspire is still not known. Those people are not here in Portugal probably these days, but we have a lot of stakeholders out there who don't know yet enough about Inspire and for whom this comes across too technical. So what we could do is we could invest a bit more in identifying sustainable environmental use cases, which go also beyond e-reporting. And we could consider an approach which has been based on a set of generic data provision, on an approach related to core data. Let's define that at some point. Bringing in or making use of the generic open data movement. And I think in order to come with the core data, we have to strengthen still the implementation of the NX1 and NX2 data to serve as a foundation for that. On the e-reporting, we have certain impacts. Our share would have been perfectly positioned to speak about that, but we are having streamlining reporting as a task. This is an ongoing task. It's triggered by various legal processes. There's some EU communication on better legislation. We have also called something called the refit process. This is looking at whether the other environmental legislation is still fit for purpose. That has been taken up on the agenda very highly, also by the current commission. There was just some encouragement by the Vice President Timmermans on the 19th of May. Of course, we have the Inspire directives, but we have also other policy instruments. So we need to reinforce here the understanding of the added benefit of Inspire in the thematic reporting. The thematic colleagues, they have their own agenda, they are very busy. We still have to succeed better to embed the thinking Inspire brings into their work. And we have to advertise ourselves. So this is the same than the second point. We have also to identify the suitable depths of integration. Do we want to address, can we address all the elements thematic discussions are addressing? Maybe we should draw a line here or there. And we know that we have to provide a more capacity building for the national implementations. There's a general governance discussion. This is on the governance. So Inspire supports the building of spatial data infrastructures in member states. And this is often beyond environment and e-reporting. Some countries are mainly positioning Inspire as a generic infrastructure initiative. I think to harvest the benefit for the environmental questions, we have to go beyond that. In some member states, it's picking up well. I don't provide details on that. We hear something later on this. In other member states, it falls behind. We know that Inspire implementation is very know-how intensive, so we're struggling with having the right know-how in our communities. I don't know about your colleagues in your offices. Are they all well aware of what the data specifications mean, how to interpret them? I think we have to do a lot of work still to educate people. And also when we think we go to the market and we buy this expertise from the consultancy companies, we find out that they're also just in the beginning of this process. They're interpreting, they are starting, they are looking at best practices. So we are all in a process of educating ourselves and moving. We have experienced that this implementation needs time. Yes, we have a lot of time, but you may not, we shall not lose over the time the motivation of the people as well. If implementation takes too much time, then this may also be somewhat a drawback. We are getting to some ideas that we, while Inspire is intended at the environmental data as a whole, we need to again focus on some foundation which we have to build. I think the foundation, while it is in principle addressed, still needs more attention. I made that point already. Inspire governance, we see, and my colleague Paul Hasenohr will show more on this later, we show that the implementation in member states is rather heterogeneous. For example, if you look at the conformity of spatial data services on the left graphic, the greener, the more the conformity is. Or if you look at the number of conformant data sets, we see quite a difference amongst the countries. So we have to work on that heterogeneity. And we also could benefit from a deeper integration across the countries in the Inspire governance process as such. We have the maintenance program. We have many experts in the maintenance programs. Some countries are very well represented, but we're missing out on other countries. And we, as I mentioned earlier, we have also this in the environmental administrations that we have to still build more the expertise on Inspire with the colleagues. A technical discussion there is. I hinted on the technical discussion that we may have to have another look at the relation between Inspire data and spatial reference data. We could benefit from having some focus where we focus on reference data stepwise and then we add other thematic data. Don't want to go in depth. There is an upcoming discussion, I heard this yesterday as well, simplification is something which people seem to call for these days. So is there a possibility for optimizing things or simplifying things from the technical side? We think that we really, by reinforcing this notion of key reference data based on Annex 1, we can achieve something and we need to further explore the concept of this reference data and how we can link that with thematic data. We had yesterday a workshop on that. We like to see and share with amongst all of us reference implementation for Annex 3. They may be very difficult to do by Annex theme because some of the Annex themes are either not very concrete or when we look at our use cases, which we have in reality, they go across Annex themes. So we have to provide reference implementations based on that. We keep hearing about concerns that there are some more rules needed, tools and guidance for validation. So countries are preparing data in what they consider an Inspire compliant way. So how to validate that? There we can do a bit more. And I think we are also on the user end side, we lacking also software tools still to use and reuse Inspire data, which is of course increasingly being provided by the stakeholders. So I would like to speak briefly about what the EEA does, the European Environment Agency, around Inspire implementation, how we motivate ourselves. So we use that Inspire implementation and our involvement into that, of course, to have a better availability of environmental data and other reference data, and to enhance interoperability across thematic areas. We would like to see a higher level of standardization and a higher level of data quality, and that we trigger by working with these thematic data flows, which are based on reporting obligations. Therefore, we suggest for ourselves that we would do a stepwise and pragmatic implementation, would like to be learning by doing. We base that on thematic interests and needs, that we have a process to agree that with our partners, I'll show that in a minute. And we're building data models, data sets and services. We're still at the very beginning on the service side. We are fully aware that we need to get out with services more to have really best practice cases. We involve our network in stages around different projects. And we are doing capacity building by providing some training, workshops with our network where we have reference centers and so on. We engage with the maintenance group, yes. There are other activities. We attend selected national Inspire events. We support EU-funded projects around Inspire, the training I mentioned already, and the IONET as well. So on the next slide, you see a set of activities which we have basically agreed to share amongst the Joint Research Center and ourselves. So where the Joint Research Center will focus on environmental reporting areas around the industry directives, floods, air quality pilot, the further development there on material flows. We will work on water data, state of the environment related, on Curry Land, on biodiversity, CDDA. We have some shared activities. So this is how we think we can stepwise support implementation to start in selected areas. A final slide from my side. So I would say implementation is stepwise happening. The time horizons are long. We keep having these discussions. When do we have to deliver some things in 2020 or 21? We would be eager to get things already sooner, but we are aware of the legal setting. But those long time horizons also bear some risks. We are waiting for some conclusions, which we are drafting to a degree together with our colleagues from DG Environment, which are based on those midterm review findings. We would tend to think that many member states can still intensify their efforts on the Inspire implementation. And we also feel that when it comes to environmental reporting and Inspire, that we still have to grow quite a bit together. So these are a set of issues which I like to share with you. And yeah, I don't know if we have time for one or two questions. There is one from Martin over there. Thank you.
Your last sentence, environmental reporting and Inspire still need to grow more together. In the last 2 years, there were some activities of the environmental reporting community, like IONET, and the Inspire community to exchange knowledge. And when we did that,
thank you. When we did that, we realized that we don't know much about each other. So I think it's very important to carry on with those activities. So is there any coordination planned to coordinate those two communities?
We have, as European Environment Agency, we have our limited means. We have our network. We can call for network meetings once, twice a year. We can entertain some expert workshops. The JRC does a similar thing. We had a big one in January. Then I have to build on you, that you and the countries, you are having your, you mirror also government governance. You have your national meetings. I know that in Germany you are doing it. I hope you are doing it. You have done it. I mean...
Sorry to interfere, but I think we need a European coordination. But I know Robert Konrad is not here.
Yeah. Well, we're taking the messages, and that is something which I also, I mean, this is actually the second point here. We have identified also in the midterm report that on coordination we could have some issues, but I think this has to be also a bottom-up approach. We cannot regulate cooperation between, mapping agencies and environmental agencies, between agencies amongst each other, between ministries and agencies. This, I don't know how to regulate that, but I'm also not a lawyer. Maybe other people have some ideas. But the point is taken. Thank you, Martin. Shall we leave it like this for the time being? Because we're running a little bit late. We have more interesting presentations, which are probably having more concrete proposals also in the same direction. I would like to ask Sabine Geissler from the SDI Coordination Office in Germany to provide the next presentation, Sabine, and where would that be? That one. Thank you, Sabine.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. My name is Sabine Geissler. I'm working in the SDI Coordination Office in Germany. And today I want to tell you a little bit about how we are performing the monitoring in this year, because it's a little bit different to what we did so far. As you know, the situation in Germany is that we are a federal state, so we managed to make out of one Inspire directive 17 laws in our country. So that means we have the different structure or a slightly different structure in the states and the way how they report the monitoring information. We do have 16 states with 16 contact points. We do have one federal contact point that is catching the federal information. And this information is running together in the SDI coordination office. Each contact point in a state has up to 200 data providers. So they also receive a lot of data from their data providers. They put it together. So far we did that in Excel sheets. And the Excel sheets were then provided to the SDI coordination office, which we merged into one to provide it to the commission. For the monitoring in 2014, we reported over more than 11,000 data sets, more than 15,000 services. And those data came from more than 650 data providers. So this is quite a lot of mess that we used to have. And we are happy that we now have another tool to manage this kind of data centrally and not to merge it and handle it via Excel sheets. So the development of the registry came in this year or end of last year, which is now one central component of the SDI Germany. We already have the Geodata catalog, the Geoportal, the test suite, and now the registry came in. The registry is an ISO 19135 compliant data model and is according to the German SDI standards and INSPIRE requirements. Main use cases are to create persistent unique resolvable IDs within Germany, which is done in the namespace register, to organize and maintain code lists, and the compilation of the monitoring information, as already mentioned. The registry was developed by the FUAS, which is the Frankfurt University of Applied Science. Part of the project has been outsourced or given to a subcontractor, which is BSpire. So you might address further questions also to BSpire that are present here on the conference as well. So this is a look now into the registry, into the registers. We do have four registers, the namespaces, the code list, the organization, and the monitoring. We will look deeper in the monitoring register. It contains, in fact, one central monitoring register where all the information is summed up for Germany. And then each state and each federal, and the federal office, they have their own registers. In here, you can see a deeper look into the monitoring register of Berlin. This is the data that has been provided for this year's monitoring period. And if we look into details, you can see that there is for each service or data set, there is one detailed and separate information available. This information is published and it's available for everybody. Also, if you are not logged in, so this is no problem to see it. So what we have just seen is the final monitoring information that was already stored in the registers. But how does the information come into that register? So we used a separate tool, the monitoring client, which is combined to the registry and also accessible via the registry. And in this monitoring client, we can prepare the data that needs to be reported. So in here, we load, we check, we update the data, and then it's going to be saved in the registry. want to show you the different features of the monitoring client. First, we need to load the data. So we can do that by requesting the monitoring information from the metadata via the Geodata catalog, or we import data via uploads of metadata files. We can further import the information via Excel sheets, so we can use the old Excel sheets that we have been using so far. We can still use them also for loading our data, basic data, into the monitoring client. And of course, a manual data input is possible. Here you see the catalog import. So you, in the first line, you can fill in the capability request, and you can set a filter to gather the information. This is in the right corner, you see the old Excel file that we were using. And actually, for this period, reporting period, we still use it in many of the states because they are used to it. But we assume that during this year, we will teach and introduce the tool more and more so that everybody can maybe use the catalog input. There's also a quality management included. So if data is loaded, it will be checked against the catalog information, the metadata catalog information, and the test read results. There's also the possibility to check single parameters only. For instance, if I want to see if my monitoring information, that the title is correct, and I want to check that against the metadata of my catalog, I can check the data and just look for this information. There's always a validation progresses in the background and also a validation for completeness. What we have figured out while using the registry and the monitoring client is that the interaction between the components give us also a control how good or bad our components are working. This is the area where we finally are preparing and correcting our data, where we compare our data, and then it needs to be sent as a proposal group to the registry. In the registry, or once the proposal group is sent to the registry, there is a control body who has to confirm the data. The control body is usually the contact point of the state, so the ones that are really responsible to provide the information. Once all the data is in the monitoring registers, we are able to report, to create our reports. So that's what we did actually also this year, to create the XML files and to the HTML files for publishing. And we do have an analyst that gives us the possibility to make more statistical evaluations on the data that we have included. And that was my last slide. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Sabine. Are there questions, one or two questions for Sabine?
Is there a question to Sabine? Ah, no. We have an opportunity to reintroduce our chairman. Is he ready? Well, I think we keep it like this. There's no question to Sabine? There's one question, Bruno.
Bruno, I have a question.
I am Bruno Rakejan from DigiAnv. I have a question about the discovery and view services. Do you have implemented, do you have specific map viewers to give access to the data set or not?
Well, the data sets and data services are visible through the registry, so the link was on one of the first slides. Let me check. You see there on the left corner at the bottom, over this link, you can look into each data set and service.
Yes, but is it user-friendly for the general public or is it for specialists?
You mean for users just to use it?
Yeah,
no, it's a quite complex process and you really have to teach the people. It's not everything is self-explaining. So, yeah, we also had a workshop to introduce the tool, but there will be probably a second one necessary to get all the possibilities through the use, to the users.
There's one more question, a final question.
Thank you very much for a nice presentation. Roberto Masgiarsi. I have a question about the identification of the data sets. Is it left on the data providers to identify which data sets belong to Inspire, or is there a national coordination discussing whether this identification is correct or whether there is more data, less data,
both.
And so on?
I would say both. There is, of course, the national law, so there might be some specialties, but of course that's our work as a coordination office to discuss exactly those things, and we do.
Okay, thank you. With that, we move to the next presentation. It's by our dear colleague Ulla Kronborg. Ulla, where are you? Ulla, Ulla, there you are. Ulla will tell us how in Denmark they are making Inspire Meta or something similar.
What was it I shouldn't touch? Oh my God.
You didn't do it yet, I think.
And it's all dark here. You can't see a thing.
Which one is it?
It's the how to make Inspire Meta. It's there.
Yeah. Okay. Hey, there we are.
Usually I'm quite good with technique. Anyhow, thank you for the invitation and Inspire matters to a lot of people, I can see. It's really a full house.
It's really a full house. Sorry. Thank you, Stefan. So, just a short outline. And the last words for now. On we go. For those of you who hadn't... I'm used to walk around when I presentate. Now I have to stay... I have to st- could I?
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. For those of you who didn't have time to read who I am, I will just present myself, that would be polite to do. I'm Ulla Kronborg Mazzoli for the National Geodata Agency in Denmark, national contact point, so pleased to meet you all. So how is Inspire doing in Denmark? Well, it was easy. It was easy with the Annex 1. It was easy for us because Annex 1 and our basic data are one-to-one. So we knew who the data owners were, and we had only a few data sets. So far, so good. We succeeded in politically embed Inspire, as I said, part of our basic data program, part of our open data. But moving to Annex 3 is a very different story. And there's a lot of data themes. There is a lot of new data owners, and many of them has no knowledge about handling geospatial information. So the challenge is a lot, not skilled, so we have a lot to do. But we are on a good track and we have established dialogue with the data owners. What we do is that we hold workshops and we have one-to-one, eye-to-eye meetings with the fairly new data owners, just to explain them from A to Z what is Inspire. But it takes a lot of communication. To make Annex 3 happen on a big scale, we have found out that it's not enough to present 600 pages of data specification. You really, really have to show them the carrot. Because the question is always, what's in it for me? Many of the data owners have already services. Their data set is functioning on a daily basis in their business, and now we're coming along asking them to slightly change data specifications and services. So they need the carrot. Of course they will do it because they have to, but we all know maintaining data at a good quality, there must be something in it for them. So those of you who attended the digital single market know that I reuse my slides. So our main goals, well, as I said, if we do not create the value for the data owners, it will be very difficult. And now we have to move from conceptual, all the talk about framework and building the SDI, and we need to go in and be very concrete and make it usable. What we see is that we really need to work locally. And when I mean locally, it's down to the individual data owner. Because right now we do not have the big lever of the pan-European use case that matters to all the different data owners. So we need to look at local value. So what we do not right now is that we try to get the services fine-tuned for the first thing. So we have the access to the data sets, that's important. So we start there, looking at the services. Then we adjust the metadata, because we found out the metadata is becoming more and more important for the users outside the agencies. So metadata must be in place and they must be understandable. And finally, we only just started on the harmonization process. We still need, though, to tie hard to the national strategies. It's quite important. It's not enough just to technically implement Inspire. And I will briefly take you through. We're sitting right now, I'm part of it, and writing on the new public digitization strategy. The one that is in charge right now is the one that had the basic data program on it, opening up the data. So where to go now? That's the big question. Of course, the public sector has to be efficient, surprise, surprise. But what is new is that it's the user that are in focus. It's end-to-end digitization, and it's seen from the outside in instead from the inside out. So that's a shift that I am very pleased with. I have underlined a few of the strategic points, where I can see that we need to bring in ISA and Inspire. So what do we do? In the Ministry for Environment, we only just recently launched a project. I have the pleasure of chairing that. And it's a project that will hopefully make sense to the Inspire data owners and to the environmental sector in Denmark as a whole, and feed into the national strategy. That's a lot. Let's see how far we go. But anyhow, the thing is that we would like to see approach it more holistically, not only data or services, but holistically. So digitization is more than IT solutions. And what do I mean by that? Well, right now we're working on this very simple picture here, saying, well, if we're going to move something, if we're going to actually harvest the efficiency values, we need to think these three items together: legislation, data, and digitization of processes. They are interlinked, and you have to be holistic about it. So what we're doing, trying to realize the full potential of digitization, we see in a number of occasions that regulation is actually a hinder. We know we have legislation coming from EU and we can hardly change that. But we can maybe be more simple in the way that we implement it. But we can definitely do something about the legislation that are purely Danish, and we will do in the environmental scene, on the environmental scene. So we're toying with the data-driven public management. I'm not quite sure what that is yet, but it's about putting data in focus, but also have an eye fixed on legislation and digitization. Yeah. So what we see, when regulation hinders digitization is that data are not adequate. You might want to regulate something using a certain data set, and then you find out that the data set or has not adequate quality or is outdated or whatever it is. We have had some cases around that. And we have processes that are very difficult to digitize because they are so complex. So what will we do? Well, we're mapping 16 legislative areas within the ministry, all from planning and forestry and waste and water and what. And then we will select three or five specific areas to do a deep dive into them and try to model either legislation or data or both. And it will all hopefully be finished by October this year. And Inspire and all that? Well, Inspire is going to bring us what we call the authoritative data. This is what we're working on. We want a pool of environmental data that when you are writing your new legislation, you dig into. You refer to those data. And you know the quality of them, and you know you can get access to them. So this is what we're going to do, heavily push Inspire into this. But we must be clear on what do we mean by authoritative. We have engaged a couple of young researchers to do the work for us. Because when we're dealing with legislation, at least for my part, it's a field I know nothing about. And it is complicated. And we need to cross over two cultures now, speaking with the lawyers and speaking with the data owners, experts. Quite interesting, really, really interesting. The big question really here is, we don't know that yet. We know that for Annex 1, it was quite suitable, almost one-to-one suitable for the purpose of being basic data in Denmark. But Annex 3, when we're speaking about regulation of the environmental sector, we do not know yet. But we will try to find out. So summing up, yeah, Inspire does matter in Denmark on a political level, absolutely. And even though it does that, and even though our politician, even at a high level, our minister, can say Inspire and even spell it, we need to keep focused because Inspire is old news. So we have to make it usable. Have to make value for the data owner. We need to do a lot of communication, geo-communication, whatever we can call them. The project that I just showed you will hopefully be the entrance to the machine. And this is what I severely hope we can bring out, because there lies the value for the data owners. Focus on local benefits and last words. The important role of the MIC. It is really important that we keep that alive and swinging, because this is where we customize Inspire for use. And we have to really back it up as member states and feed into MIC, because we need to customize Inspire. The more we use Inspire, the more we find that we have to customize. That's my thesis anyhow. So it bridges also e-government with Inspire. And we need to have a pool where we can harvest our experiences. So MIC is important. We still need to be very, very tightly linked with the digital agenda, Inspire. And I see this working group on spatial information and services as one of the tools. So I can only say to all of you, look into this working group. They're doing some very, very interesting works. Some pilots are coming up. And we need to keep on linking to the digital agenda, because there lies the money. And again, I was glad to see your presentation, Stefan, because we really, really need that. We really need to link environmental reporting and Inspire closer together. So working together, a common goal, we will get there. We might take some swings or back turns, but I'm sure keeping it fixed, working together, we will get it. Thank you all.
Thanks so much, Ulla, for this very good reflections from the from the national perspective, I think you're really leading us in terms of showing what one can do in countries and how one can put Inspire into a necessary context to other e-government activities. Are there one or two questions for Ulla? Yes.
Thank you. This is working? Yes. Thank you, Ulla. Maria Cabello from Racasa, Spain. I have a question for you. You have mentioned that on the Annex 3 is more difficult. Yes, I totally agree with you. But you also mentioned that you try to balance in some way. And I would like to know how you are able, if you succeed or your experience, just for this Annex 3, just trying to how to balance the idea of harmonization at European level with providing local value for this Annex 3 that at the end, in some cases, is for business purpose. So how you can go, because we also have this problem from Annex 3, some of the themes that we have the people involved in our Inspire implementation, but when we say, and you have to do that because you are the owner of this information that you should provide and so on, and they say, come on, for what purpose? What if I need for my business and only for my business? I don't want to do that. So any other should do. So how do you experience or balance or?
Now it would be very nice if I could just tear up this how to do it, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I can't. But what we're doing in Denmark and actually together with my Nordic colleagues as well is work on examples. For instance, the marine SDI asks about thematic data on the marine field. So there's a good point. There's a good example. You need that. And again, pilots cross-border or cross-regional, cross-sector. So working with examples. That's the best answer I can give you.
Thank you. Thank you once more, Ulla. Thank you for the question. I would like to ask Joep Crompvoets now from the University of Leuven to provide us with the next presentation. And there are still some seats over there if people are missing. So.
Yeah, download it.
Thank you very much for introducing me. My name is Joep Crompvoets, and as you see, I'm not the only author. The main author, Ian Masser, is not here at the moment. He is not in a position to come here. The presentation that I would like to do is about analyzing the country reports that you all worked quite hard on it. In 2013, you delivered that one. And I just want to give you a brief reflection, a brief review of the results what we have done. So monitoring and reporting. And the first four slides, I have to admit, are rather boring because I refer directly to the directive and placed in the context. And for example, you know, all aware of the Article 21, where member states shall monitor the implementation and use of the SDI. And they shall make the results of this monitoring accessible to the Commission and to the public on a permanent basis. Nothing new for you. And as you know, there are two ways to monitor in Inspire. We have a quantitative approach, and Sabine informed us earlier much about it, about these 8 indicators, and they are based on a list of reported data sets and services of each country. A qualitative report, because besides the quantitative measurement, we also have written reports. And these written reports provide qualitative information on the progress. And these provisions, these are set in the directive also. What should be included in it? This should be included in somehow referring to coordination and qualitative assurance. Should also refer this in this report, should also tackle somehow the functioning and coordination of the infrastructure, the usage of the infrastructure, and the data sharing arrangements, and the cost-benefit aspects. And also, and that's also written in the directive, I sound a little bit boring, but every 3 years thereafter, the member states shall also send to the Commission a report providing updated information. And the Commission, GSC, was so kind to provide this a nice template. Also, it's good to be aware of, besides these country reports, that the Commission is obliged to do some periodic reviews. And we heard all from Stefan about this midterm review. He's reflecting to that. And there is that each in each 6 years thereafter, the Commission shall present to the European Parliament and to the Council a report on the implementation of this directive based, inter alia, on reports from the member states in according to the articles, blah, blah, blah. 2013 country reports. I refer to not to the first round, but to the second round of qualitative country reports. And what you see, the template that I showed you was almost the same as the one in 2013. So that templates were done in order to force the member states to write the documents in a systematic way. The difference with the 2013 compared to 2010 was that the cost-benefit aspects were slightly expanded. Deadline was 15th of May 2013, and 27 countries submitted it on a reasonable term their documents. 27. Croatia joined on the 1st of July, so was not forced to submit that document on time. Also is that many states submitted their documents in their own language, and the documents, each documents were translated in English. A crude measurement, quantitative measurement for regarding the output of these documents can be described by means of length of pages and the coverage. I know it is very crude, but as a first set of a first way to present what's all in it. And here we see a table. Here you see the 27 member states, and we see the five different topics. And on the end, on the right column, the number of pages. And there on each column, you see the number of pages related to each topic. 2013 report outputs. What we saw that the sizes are significantly longer than the first round. The total number was more than 2,000 pages altogether compared to the 700 pages in 2010. The average length as a consequence was also longer, 39 pages compared to 26 pages. The shortest reports were from Luxembourg and Ireland. Meanwhile, and I'm happy that I'm here in Lisbon, the longest reports are from Portugal and Spain. Well done. Muito obrigado. What we see also is that the longest topics refer to coordination and functioning. I think that's not a surprise when we are still in the stage of infancy in the first year, is that a lot of effort has taken place on coordination and the functioning. But what we see, what strikes me and Ian Musser a lot, is that we don't have so much figures about the usage. Come on. The data infrastructure should be used, and not should be just established, but should be used. And there, but therefore, I hope in the next report seeing much more pages, much more content referring to the use of this data infrastructure. We have not built this infrastructure for nothing. So, what we also see is a significant improvement of the quality of the reporting concerning costs and benefits. However, it's still quite difficult to measure the benefits. Overall, we think that the overall impression of the implementation is quite well on the way, and necessary steps are being taken in the member states. Now I refer, because Stefan Jensen, you went very quickly through this, through the midterm review, and you went already after what's happening after midterm review. Be aware that we have that the directive started in 2007, and hopefully it will be fully implemented in 2021. So 2014 was an excellent moment, midterm review, how we are doing. And what I would have to say that these country reports were quite an important input of this to this review. But also not that only alone, there were also other sources, of course. And one of the main one was the public consultation, which took place in 2013 and running in the summer, on the winter of 2014. And that was done in order to attain views on the content to which the implementation access was still on course. Thank you. Nearly 700 people responded. What we also see in the report, and the authors of this midterm review also refer that the quality of the country reports are significantly increased. The quality is significantly increased, so well done. We look forward to the 2016 months. Even then, the quality will be hopefully much better. But that's a big concern, and also we ourselves see it, that not much attention is given to inspire, to improve the implementation for implementing environmental policies or policies that affect environment. That's it all about. So please, in the next reports, consider this issue. It is still too much technical focused, those reports. This brings me to the discussion. Because I'm a scientist, and Ian Massel, we are scientists, we like always to think about everything, is the Inspire qualitative monitoring differs fundamentally from other SDI or spatial data assessment approaches, such as the SDI readiness, the state of play approach, the geometry maturity model in Abu Dhabi, etc., as it is based on self-evaluation. And the strength of this approach is that it's placing the onus for reporting on those organizations that are directly engaged in the implementation. Excellent. And it draws upon the combined knowledge and experiences of national communities who are preparing these reports. The weaknesses could be that could be too optimistic of national circumstances. Do they tell what the Commission wants to hear, rather what is actually happening in reality? Could be the case. If you think this is all short, and I know because I respect the time, so therefore I would like to only give a very brief overview of what's presented about these reports. More than 60 pages are about this review of the 2013 review, and you can find it in this book. And a free copy can be found at the booth of ESRI. But we have still some questions, follow-up questions. The last slide. Who was centrally involved in the preparation of the 2013 approach? That we would like to know. Also, how were the stakeholders consulted, directly, indirectly? And what can be learned from the process of preparing the 2013 reports? What can we learn from it to make even the quality of the 2016 reports better? And are you preparing to make some changes in your process to set up these written reports? Have the authors of the country reports looked at any other country reports? Just an observation. Have they learned from each other how the way they are tackling that reporting? And last but not least, have the authors had any feedback from the EEA or the Commission on their reports? And have they had received any feedback from the country? This is my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Joep, for that look into our qualitative reporting. I think we are all aware that we can enhance the comparability, the depth of that reporting, and we will bring some ideas forward for the next reporting, we are sure, and we're happy to take your recommendations on board. Is there a short question to Joep? Yes?
Nathalie Delat from Belgium. Well, for me, what is really important regarding the way we can progress in the quality of this reporting is I seem to have some reader's feedback. And I would emphasize the last question, have the authors had any feedback from, from a European agency and commission. And I think that the first side is that we have to be to know if what we are providing is under stable, we have provided all the information that suit for purpose. And then we can come back to our different stakeholders and writers. But for me, this is the very beginning to have a kind of reaction of the quality of the report we provide so far. Thank you.
Thank you. I fully agree with you.
Merci, Nathalie. One final shot.
Yeah, I will do it quickly. You had one of your first slides where you scored the reports long is good. Short is not.
I said it's a crude measurement, but okay, you good? Yes.
I'm alongside you, my colleague here. Let's see what's in it, right? Quality of what's written.
Exactly. I fully agree. It is about the content, not about.
I think we have a nice handover to the next presentation by Paul Hasenohr. Paul is going to present us the results of the indicator-based reporting, which are very fresh, available from this month, actually. So I think this adds, complements the discussion nicely because it sheds a light on the quantitative part of the reporting. And Paul, the floor is yours.
Thank you. So after the qualitative, I will go to the pure quantitative presentation. Just first, a very few words about monitoring and reporting, but that will be extremely short because we are running out of time. And then the main focus is indeed about the implementation status of Inspire, seen through the monitoring indicators. And this year, compared to last year, and this year the focus will be on the last 3 years, so the last three reports that we had to see what is the trend. And then what is the ongoing work around monitoring. So monitoring, you have already seen it in the previous presentation. Monitoring and reporting, there is a regulatory framework, so I will not speak more about it. What are the main changes between last year and this year? That we introduced a new file format to exchange the Inspire monitoring data between member states and the environmental agency. It's based on an XML template that was used already in the past by two member states, but now more and more, majority of member states used this new format. And we have also provided tools in order to generate this data. But not to generate the data, but to generate it according to our new format. So that can be done either manually or even semi-automatically by using the information contained in the national geoportal. So the first one is a web tool that basically allows member states who are still using their Excel, the old Excel templates, to take the data from the Excel file and convert it into an XML that then we can automatically process. And there is another application that has been developed that allows two things, mainly to visualize the information that is reported, that one aspect, and the other aspect that allows also to create semi-automatically, the monitoring indicators based on the information that is contained in the national catalogs. And so this is the Inspire dashboard, and that is conceived by the MIG, so by a subgroup of the MIG, while the web tool is just something that is 100% EA. So the deliveries, the very good news, I must say, this graph, so all the graphs and maps that you are going to see are taken from this dashboard that I just mentioned before. Here you see all reports, all monitoring data that is available from member state in either, has been provided either in XML or Excel, so for the past 3 years. And you see that for this year, I mean, we are in fact in quite a good, considering that there are only six member states missing. Last year, at the same time, you would have seen a lot of more white boxes. So there has been really an improvement, and also the fact of having changed the file format has allowed for faster processing, because the deadline was the 15th of May, and we are the 24th or 25th, so this would have not have been possible last year at all. So now, figures, a lot of maps. Number of special data sets reported. Basically, it is stable for most member states, as you can see, with a few exceptions. And the few exceptions, you will see that member states that were already reporting a lot of data sets have kept increasing their number of data sets. It keeps increasing. But it's good. For very few, there has been a drop, which needs to be further analyzed. So now, in terms of existence of metadata, what is important to see, the darker it is, the better. And you see that in terms of existence of metadata, therefore, we are doing good. We are really improving. It's dark. It's getting darker and darker over the years. Now, if we split it by annexes. Annex one, I would say not surprisingly, is good. Well, that has to be good. Annex two is still good, but unfortunately not anymore as good as it was for Annex one. And now if we go to Annex three, it is the one that still needs improvement. Now regarding the special data services. Again, that has been really improving over the years. I mean, look at the values for 2012. The blue means zero, I mean between 0 and 20% for the indicator on availability of special data services, existence of metadata for special data services. And you have quite a lot of yellow. This year, at least for member states who have reported, it is improving. It's not yet perfect. We see that there are still member states lacking behind compared to others. In terms of conformity of metadata, again, here I would see it as quite positive. I hope that you agree. Conformity overall is increasing. And again, not surprisingly, Annex 1 is better than Annex 2 and especially Annex 3. Conformity of special data, of metadata for special data services, also again over the years, it got darker and darker. Still, you will notice that there are some countries who remain unfortunately yellow or blue over the years, which means then that they do not have that much metadata conformant. In terms of accessibility of the metadata through discovery services, still here, and similar to the previous three slides, the message is positive. It's indeed improving over time. With, we can see for Spain, a sudden drop that would have to be analyzed because it's quite surprising. It increased from 2012 to 2013 and then 2014 decreased. But we have not yet had time to investigate further as we just got the data, as I said, 10 days ago. In terms of availability and conformity of special data sets, that's unfortunately where the maps are not going to look as nice as before. Number of data sets reported for this year, pay attention that this is a logarithmic scale. So we have a few we have three, let's say mainly three member states reporting a very large number of data sets, which are Germany, France, and the UK. And now looking at the number of conformant special data sets for Annex 1. As you can see on the left you have the number of data sets that are reported. Keep in mind that the previous scale was logarithmic with a maximum at 10,000, slightly more than 10,000. Here, the maximum is 140, no, sorry, there was a maximum at 295. That was for Italy for last year. But we have not yet received the data for Italy for this year. But otherwise, I mean, consider that the maximum is around 150. While we were speaking about 10,000 data sets before. So it's quite low, and that's Annex 1. Now, Annex 2, getting worse. And Annex 3, I would not say that it's getting better. Over time, it will improve. Now, conformity of special data sets, then put as indicator, so as ratio of conformant data sets versus the number of data sets reported. So we, for 2012, I think we have three countries, which are not blue, so which are in fact above 20%. 2013, did not really improve a lot, except for three member states, I would say. 2014, still quite bad. Now, if we look more in detail, Annex 1, lot of blue that's getting slightly green. I mean, now it's getting greenish, let's say. Annex 2, not really. And Annex 3, in best case, it's getting yellow. Now, accessibility of special datasets through view and download services. It has been improving over the past years. It has been improving. It is still bad. It's to be kept in mind also that for some member states, I think there is a problem with the data that they have reported, simply. Because it's very surprising that there is actually that their data is not available through view and download services, but just that the data, the way it has been reported was probably with some mistakes. Then in terms of view services, you see that view services, really, the availability of data sets through view services is really increasing over the years. I mean, that's really improving. That's a very positive thing. The download services, it's not improving, I would say, as quickly as for the view services. Network services availability and conformity, the number of services reported remains quite stable for most member states. Again, a few countries which are reporting a lot of services, a lot of conformant even services, and most are reporting in the range of 100 or less. So conformity of discovery network services, that has evolved over time in a strange way, because it's at some point it improved, then it decreased again, and strangely. View network services, it's not that much conformant, it's slightly improving, but not that much. And in terms of conformant download services, there are less conformant download network services than view services. So just to conclude about the ongoing work around monitoring, there is some work still ongoing in the MIG, the MIWP 16. This group has been active since January last year. And our focus is still on developing further the dashboard to better support an automated monitoring and to improve also the visualization of indicators. That's one activity. And the second activity will be on reviewing the indicators, the aim being to improve the quality of reported data. Just to conclude also, the dashboard can be seen also at the Inspire stand if you want to see it, and if you have also any feedback that you want to provide about Inspire in general, you are welcome to fill in some kind of postcard that are available at the Inspire stand and to put them there. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Paul, for these interesting analytical findings. I think we could have a long further elaboration of this. One very short question only.
Thank you, Stefan. It's more like a note to the presentation. I think it's very important that we can look into the other member states. On the other hand, I find it quite difficult to compare countries with a number of data sets of like 100 data sets and other countries like Germany with 11,000. Isn't there or are there any ideas of doing a different kind of evaluation? It would be nice to look on key data sets, what we really need in Europe, for instance, hydrographic networks or traffic, things like that, and then really look at the harmonization and look at the question, can we use those data sets on a European scale?
Yes, thank you for the question. I think that this, I mean, here, that was a representation of the indicators as they exist today. It's clear that under the activities of reviewing the indicators, likely the usefulness of some of them would need to be reassessed, likely.
Thank you. Thank you for the question also. I think, yes, we are aware of that. We have to, we work with on that in the MIG context. And now Marc Leobé is coming up to the stage here for the last presentation. Please, to the audience, bear with us another narrow 15 minutes. We have a final presentation by Marc Leobé. And then we have a short intervention by Robert Konrad from DG Environment, who wants to make a few remarks on the political process, which is around this Inspire implementation. I think this will, in a useful way, round up our discussions this morning. So if you please bear with us another 15 minutes. Coffee will still be there for you, and yeah, sorry for that delay here.
Can you close? No one. So, yes, thank you. So, thank you to have stayed up to now. So, as a bonus, you get two free presentations. First, if you want to know how we do the monitoring in France, please see Sabine Geissler presentation, because we are very near from a German implementation. And second, if you want to know what are the global trends in France, please see Ulla presentation, because we are very near in the thinking, except we are for the first day of Inspire implementation focused on Annex 3. And so, my name is Marc Leobé. I'm working about Inspire negotiation and implementation for French authorities. And we spend many time on implementing models and so on, data models and so on, with European Commission and colleagues from other member states. And we put them in reality. I've seen absolutely nothing. Yeah. And so the abstract of my presentation is my conclusion, to be short. and so up to now, we are used to get UML model on to try to implement UML model. So in France, we give empty data, empty files to people to be able to work under quantum GIS or ArcGIS and so on. And so then people are managing the data model on their own. And after, through the cloud, they are throwing the data to end users and see the face of the end users. Of course, you can't reach interoperability, and we have many problems to integrate that in information systems. And what we have learned with implementation of flood directive in France is, in fact, we have to let the people working on flood, working on the computers, without any idea of the data model. They don't care. And so, with freeing the cloud, somewhere you have the data model. and somewhere you have something which happened, and you give the answers, you give the result to the end users, to the insurances, to the people working on the public security and so on. And the UML have to be in a black box. So I will try to explain you, because we are very pro to work with European Commission on data models, we took the model of the technical working group natural risk zone to be able to implement data flood directive reporting with the data model of Inspire. And we have the chance to got the editor of the TAWG because he was French. And we decided to use Inspire infrastructure to be able to report data for flood directive. But the production in France is delegated to regional services, and we have very heavy constrained deadlines because of the flood directive, every organization, because we have to do all the job in 2 years, and a major challenge for the ministry, of course. So every pressure on everybody. And in last November, my colleagues working on the natural hazards asked me about some compliance issues about the flood data standards. And so, just before Christmas, I asked to my colleagues in regional services, did you encounter difficulties implementing TRI standards? And the result is yes. And so the main feedbacks is 2/3 of all services encounters real difficulties. They are not small services. There are at least 4 or 5 specialists of geodata in each regional service. So it's heavy organizations on their side. But because of all the job you have with hazards, 4 type of hazards, you know, with all the thing, they have to outsource the work outside the judicial. And most of them considered the model as complex, especially when you compare the skills you are able to get in the services on what you expect to have to do a right job. Most difficult is the standard seems to be open to interpretation. And because everybody is in front of his computer with QGIS most of the time and ArcGIS sometimes in this job, if you are open to interpretation, you can't imagine to get a full interoperability, especially under semantic aspects. So the model is not compatible with QGIS on map server. So it's, of course, a big problem when you are going to publish WMS. And we lack to define the production. And all that job just to have 14% of dataset compliant following the national validator. And so it didn't seem to be a very good result. The good point is nobody put under question the fact to have a national standard based on a European standard, of course. And so the analysis we are continue to do in France is most of the time, because they are very big services, the drill overcome the difficult. But it's not possible to expect that result at lower level in France, that is, department and municipalities. Because of the delays that they spend to be compliant, most of the half of them drop Inspire model and send PDF to European Commission for flood directive reporting. It's not a good point for us, and especially for EEA. And so because they have to publish flood data on the Inspire framework, they have to do the job twice. It's a pity, of course. And what we have learned is that is we have the same problem with French experts that we had with European experts. They are very far away from the producers in my country. And the two points very important in my mind is when you have very tough guys saying you, what is the value of this complexity? And the answer is not very easy. And when many express the opposition, conform versus usable. And of course, when you are working on fluid, you want to be usable because you have many things to do after with citizens, with authorities. And always they have to choose to be usable. And I think it is a good way to decide when you are at local level. So the conclusion at this time, it is first the story of the validator. You just check one implementation. Today we don't know how to check the compliance of the data to the implementing rule, to the regulation. And so we decide at national level to develop one validator with one implementation, but because of the diversity of the producers, it doesn't work. So it's a very big point to not be able to say you are compliant, you are not compliant about fluid. And so the idea, we're working weeks and months on that because it's not the way we were thinking about. The problem is not the model complexity. The problem is the human skills you be able to reach in your services. And the understanding of the model and the interpretation. And so the more you will give the end to the data producers, to the model, the more you will be in front of the same thing that we saw in fluid data. And so the idea is to reduce the interpretation possibility and to, I think, for example, if we had to do that again in France, we will talk with only two or three people, maybe four, to implement data model in one tool and don't let anybody touch to the data model. That is, we have to use a specific tool for each standard to prevent people to do job we don't need, in fact, because everybody in France thinks the national level is not very clever, and they are most clever because they are on the ground, on the field, and they know the flood, and they know the towns, and they know the cities on the field. But that's not the job we asked for. We asked for a national view to be able to make priorities, and it's a command we made. And so we need a generic data management system like PostgreSQL, for example, with an overlay of open to producer to produce data, but in very narrow way. And so the scheme, as I showed in the beginning with the black box, that is that. So today in France, we have one tool developed by our national mapping agency, but we have to put this tool in the hand of people. So we have an organizational issues, we have cultural issues, we have many, many things to change if we would like to be able to produce harmonized data at the national level. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark, for this report from the practice and for some suggestions how to maybe simplify things and provide more ease to implementation. If we don't have a question, this is also fine, then we move directly to Robert since we are stressing your time anyhow. Or do we have a question? I should be fair. No, you missed your opportunity. Here's Robert.
Yep.
Robert will have some remarks on the
No,
the light function. Doesn't work, sorry.
Yeah. Anyway, good morning, everybody. First of all, I apologize. I should have started this workshop, but now I will conclude it. The program I was working with was having this session at a different time and different place, so apologies for it. But there is also a little bit of a benefit because I think that my intervention is better to conclude on the basis of the previous kind of a national experiences. So as you may remember, we have met a year ago in Denmark, where we have already been discussing the evaluation of the Inspire directive. At that time, we were discussing it as the evaluation under Article 23 of the Inspire directive, and we have already envisaged that Inspire is going to be part of the regulatory fitness performance program of the European Commission, that is the program of an extensive evaluation of any any legislation. In the past, only main kind of a significant pieces of legislation were subject to the refit program, but as you may have noted a few days ago, the new European Commission came up with the better regulation package, the message that actually it wants to do a TORAF evidence-based policy making, and that basically the ex ante and ex post evaluation will apply to all of its policies. The better regulation program is indeed introducing some new elements, and what is important, it also directly relates to the Inspire. So basically, we are in the situation where from original intention to have the report under Article 23, we went through, let's say, additional requirements of the regulatory fitness program. And now we are in a final stage where we still need to consider the new requirements and the new setup of the better regulation agenda. For example, the part of the better regulation agenda is the scrutiny board, which also includes the external stakeholders. So we are all anxious to see actually what will be the practical implication of this new arrangement for the Inspire. Now, when we met last time in Denmark, we were basically at the verge of, or shortly before the publication of the EEA midterm evaluation report. And the report has been structured, and I'm sure that you know all of it, so there is no need to go into any further detail. The report has had a standard structure, and in the meantime, Commission report, which is now falling under these three, let's say, subsequent processes, was being adopted in the light of the following better regulation criteria. The first criterion, or first criterion, is the relevance. So we need to ask ourselves the question: to what extent the issues addressed by Inspire are matching current needs, and to what extent they continue to require action at the EU level, and whether the general and specific objectives of the Inspire are still relevant, and whether the actions are appropriate or need to be modified. So much for the relevance. Then another question was of the EU added value, which means what is the EU added value of Inspire vis-a-vis member state activities. The third question is the efficiency, asking whether the costs and benefits associated with the implementation of the Inspire directive in the member states are actually having some positive, if possible, quantifiable impacts on the efficiency of public authorities and possible other public users, and is there any room to make Inspire more cost-effective? The further question was the effectiveness, asking what progress has been made over the time towards the achievements and the targets. set out in Inspire in the various member states and whether that progress is in line with the initial expectations and whether it's, for example, geographically consistent. And then the last big refit question was the question of the coherence, meaning whether the Inspire is interacting with the other policy and initiatives in a coherent way with the generation of positive benefits and whether there is a scope for a better alignment. And last but not least, whether there are any provisions in the Inspire that needs to be identified as obsolete and acted upon. So with these five questions being a guiding question of the exercise, and with all the kind of evolving agendas which I have tried to describe in a very short way, we are at the moment in the stage where, in anticipation of being subject to a new, better regulation scrutiny, we are preparing the report of the Commission and as well as the staff working document. And although I cannot at the moment discuss the detailed wording, I think this session is particularly useful and appropriate for sounding of at least some of the preliminary conclusions we have arrived at in the process. And of course, we have arrived at together with you based on your input and based on the data and assessments like those that were presented here a moment ago. So we are inclined to conclude that the Inspire in general is fit for purpose, although there are some delays and there is a different rate of progress achieved by the member states. Now, what cannot be questioned is the relevancy and the EU added value, which we can see on the basis of the best practices, which are being applied by more advanced member states, as well as the lesson learned. But however, there can be a number of recommendations how to further enhance effectiveness, efficiency, and coherence of Inspire actions. Now, let us remind ourselves that the Inspire roadmap is spanning until 2020, and it may actually be even longer. So we are in the middle of the implementation, and it's only natural that there are the implementation gaps that needs to be addressed. So closing these gaps is actually something we should all work towards in the next few years. Now, these gaps are particularly related to the issues like capacity building, cross-border coordination, and measures for the removal of technical and procedural obstacles to data sharing at the point of use. This is, I think, the main finding. Now, from the point of view of the Commission, the initiatives like the better regulation and the digital single market are particularly relevant to ongoing implementation of Inspire, as they basically provide a more narrow focus and actually also the support to the governance objectives. Now, being more detailed, if you don't mind, just perhaps a few additional minutes, and then we can continue with the bilateral discussions and the reactions. We are going to recommend to the report is going to recommend to the member state and to the European Commission to further intensify the coordination activities and involvement of the stakeholders at all relevant levels of governments as well as private sectors. And we see especially the potential of the private-public partnership as a resource that could add to the already growing economic value of Inspire. Now, what is more operational conclusions, which will be discussed also, I think, in our coordination meetings at the end of the conference, is that, as we have seen, there is various progress across the data sets, across the different annexes. And it's very important that the member states, the Commission, and the EEA will actually prioritize those data sets under INSPIRE that are required for meeting the statutory reporting obligations under the environmental acquis. So this is now going to be the main focus. We are going to launch under the better regulation agenda a rolling program on the better reporting, and we see the INSPIRE as the enabling infrastructure and see a clear need to show how INSPIRE is able to deliver on the statutory reporting under the environmental acquis. And then, of course, so this was actually the main point which I wanted to highlight at this session. And then, of course, we are going to have a, let's say, more general recommendations concerning the better alignment with the digital single market. And last but not least, a number of recommendations how to actually make better funding or make a better use of the funding opportunities for the INSPIRE. We know that there is, especially regarding the funding, a very diverse level of the capacities. There is a huge funding gap. So indeed, the Commission is going to come up with the number of actions to address the resource concern, I mean the funding. But of course, on the side of the member states, it's also very important that there the resource concern is also addressed, and that basically INSPIRE is being promoted as a part of the interoperability of the public administration and the e-government program. Perhaps that would be, at this moment, enough of the details, I'm looking forward to your reactions and comments. And once again, apologies for closing rather than opening this session. Thank you.